RadioMatchMusic.com. That is Ronnie Mishap there, and Accept My Love. It's 15 past top of the hour, and then we're here with Laura Kovacs and Omega Train.
Hello.
And I'm going to relax for a little while, and it's all yours.
All right. Hi, everyone. I am Laura Kovacs, as you just heard. I'm here with Omega Train, with Darren and Kenny. How are you guys doing?
Hey, what's up?
Hey, going to church today. Church at the Cobra, man. Yeah.
And that's Darren. All right, so let's see what you guys want to do first. You want to just speak your mind there? Either one of you? Just go with
it. I'm the quiet one.
He's the quiet one? Come on, Darren. I know you're not.
Virginia Ham, so I got to do my thing and talk. Now, just talk about the history of Omega Train. If you've never heard of us, I can't believe that, but if you never heard
of Omega Train,
We go way back, way back. There was an old band back in the day called Industrial Avenue, that's what we were called. That was me singing in very exciting suits of a high top fade with a guy named John David Woods playing guitar, Danny Casseri playing drums, Mike Haikowski on the other guitar, and Mark Fahad on bass.
The one and only.
Yes, the one and only Mark. And we'd play some, we tried. Mm-hmm. We tried, and we played places like Alcibelli's Reginald's down on the Amboy border, Perth Amboy, and Jammers up in Woodbridge, and we had some
Jammers,
some backyard parties. And
now, how old were you guys when you first started getting together?
Geez Louise, it was still college. I think it was like, I guess I was 20.
Okay.
1920, and we were doing our things. This is back 87, 88, that kind of area.
Mm-hmm.
And we had fun, but you know what, you can only go so far when people are moving around and doing their thing,
right?
And this kind of one of those things, so we kind of wanted to do something else. So me and Mark got together, the Outlaw, we call this, my brother Mark.
The Outlaw.
That he is.
This boy is just gets stuff done.
Yes.
Don't ask him how he gets it done, but he gets it done. That's the Outlaw. And so he wanted to play guitar. That's his deal. He plays bass. He plays a great bass, but he is an axe slinger.
Yeah.
He's a guitar player, and he comes up with the most outrageous riffs you want to hear, and it's just in him. It's who he is.
Mm-hmm.
And so we said, well, we got to do something. So we first came with a group. There were guys like, we had a guy named Mark Jacoby on bass. And Guitar Lamar was there for a little bit of time. Marty from Marty and the Martians. Marty Mayo.
Really?
What's up, brother man? He was out there doing his thing. And then my boy, Kenny, came in the fold as drummer.
Yeah.
Hitting the sticks.
You were hitting the sticks, man. So, you know, Ken plays a lot. How many instruments do you play?
It's too many.
He's got a banjo sitting in his...
I know. I think I remember that. I think I remember the damn banjo.
Yeah. He's got a little country.
Yeah.
And, you know, we did our little thing back then and did some Battle of the Band stuff, but then we were called Last Train Out.
Yes, I recall
then.
That. I recall.
LTO, Last Train Out. And so, you know, like I said, bands are marriages.
Mm-hmm.
So some marriages don't work. So some of the people left and we migrated other people in. So now Danny Blaz, the bombastic one, took over drums.
Mm-hmm.
Ken went to guitar because he plays 1,200 instruments anyway. He went to guitar. Yes, yes. Mm-hmm. And then... we had a gentleman named Bruce Leboff come in on bass.
Bruce Leboff.
Bruce
killer bass player.
Amazing.
Berkeley guy.
Yeah,
Berkeley.
Went to Berkeley School of Music.
Oh, wow.
Amazing guy. Knows his music theory. Knows tablature. All that good stuff, man. Yes, he does. He's he is awesome. And we started gigging out. We started gigging out and doing things and playing places like Jammers to start and different Battle of Bands things.
This is in New Jersey, USA. We're worldwide here.
Yeah, I know. It's like, well, so if you're in the Jersey scene, you know what we're talking about. If you're in Upper Botswana, I'm sorry.
Come to Jersey then.
Just Google it. Yeah. Google it, and it'll take you right to where we were talking about back in the day. We didn't have Google back then.
No.
No. We had beepers and stuff.
Oh, God.
They were around.
Yeah. If I had a purple one, it didn't work. But I just had it on there just to say, hey, I got a beeper.
Long before the internet.
Yes, exactly.
God, way before.
Before you went to Google and Craigslist and post your music, you know, we sent our demos to anybody and everybody in the world.
Oh, yeah.
You know, on Suge Knight.
On cassette tapes.
The one who's in prison now?
Yeah. They had those ones, boys and girls, something back in our day, cassette tapes.
Oh, yes.
This little...
Which I actually still have mine.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know why, but I do.
I was like, yeah, oh, damn, I should have asked somebody to... I should have got a cassette and somebody to record this thing today. I said, well, wait a minute, it's a pod thing I have to
say. Yeah. Podcast, yes.
Exactly. People had Walkmans, something called a Walkman.
Oh, my God. I remember those.
Yeah. It's like, you know, you had to clip into your belt. It's heavy and bulky and stuff, and the wires get clipped. it's all bad. But getting back to what we were doing. So, you know, covers are fun. Mm-hmm. They are fun. They pay the bills. Covers pay the bills. But it's not the same as an original. It's the same as the creativity you get from writing your own stuff.
Right.
And, you know, with the people we have around me, like Ken is Mr. Riff Guy. He can write songs. He's a songwriter. Mark's a riff guy. Mm-hmm. He writes songs, songwriter. It wasn't hard to really write songs with these guys. Mm-hmm. It really wasn't.
You can't be a rock star playing covers.
Yeah. No, that's for sure.
No. Unless you're a rock star, right?
There you go.
That's true. Yeah. That's very true.
So what on the CD right here, you guys wrote all the songs, correct?
Yes, we did. Yeah, yes, we awesome. Did. It's a combination of mostly people, me and Ken and Mark. And Mark, we wrote most of these songs, and it was a beautiful thing.
It's just for you.
And, sweet. I'm telling you, the fun part about writing with these guys is you take the ego out of the room.
Uh-huh.
If there's something that works, they go, Darren, that works. Doesn't work, they say, oh, Darren, try something else. And it's not, and we could do that and throw that back to each other, and nobody gets a sore ass or has problems or difficulties. We just,
something's always very easy with this group of guys.
It's just an easy way. Yeah. We just flowed with
just
it.
Flowed, yeah.
And one of the first things that we did in recording wise is we went to a place that was run by a guy named Steve Massal.
Mm-hmm.
And he was the percussionist for Billy Idol on mm-hmm. White Wedding
mm-hmm.
Single. And people remember the White Wedding CD, and there's a big thump in it. There's a boom, 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 boom. And we thought it was a drum.
Mm-hmm.
No.
Mm-hmm.
It's a bit of rock trivia here for you folks.
Yeah.
It was a piano case and a mallet.
Wow.
So you make an instrument out of a piano case and a mallet.
This guy tells a story always like your grandpa on the porch. Like,
yeah.
Oh, Jerry. Well, that's
where's
that
s'mores?
That's that slice of Virginia ham that I be. You know, we're going to church today, so I better preach. That's how I feel about it. But the first track off the Three Alarm Fire CD that I want to talk about is something we recorded there. That's track one called Flat Out. This was a song written by Mr. Mark Fahad, the Outlaw.
Yes.
And it's a song about the need for speed.
Mm-hmm.
And I get to, you know, do a little vocal yelps on it. It's a lot of fun. It's got a high energy kind of thing to kick us off. Short, sweet, to the point.
All right, we're going to play it right now.